All right, let's get started. Good morning, everyone. And thank you for joining OSI's Oracle Edge Apps webinar. My name is Glenn Gazelle, and I'll be hosting our event today. Joining me is my colleague Manoj Devireddy. He is a Senior Vice President at OSI, and he leads our global enterprise mobility practice. From an agenda standpoint today, we're going to be reviewing some industry trends with regards to enterprise mobility and a review of the challenges we see with Oracle's mobile enterprise application platform. We're going to follow that up with an overview of OSI's Oracle Edge App solution, including a demo and Q&A. If you have questions along the way, please send them through the chat feature. You should find that on the right side of your screen, and we're going to try to answer as many of those as we can at the end of the presentation. Mobility is having quite an impact on our everyday lives right now, including the way we work. Many of you are probably seeing that within your own businesses. It's estimated there will be over 10 billion mobile devices in use in the coming year, and this has really brought us to a mobile-first world that is changing how customers expect to interact with your business, as well as changing how businesses communicate and collaborate internally. So why should you consider mobilizing your Oracle application? Well, according to Gartner, a large majority of businesses have found that mobilizing their EDS applications has enabled them to perform their business processes faster, easier, and more efficiently. OSI's Oracle Edge App solution is one way that our customers are accomplishing this. So you might be wondering about Oracle's mobile enterprise application platform. Maybe some of you have heard of it. Maybe some of you have seen it. And you might be wondering how it differs from OSI's solution. So we're going to review some of the differences and challenges that we see associated with the standard Oracle option. Number one, the first limitation is that you cannot mobilize customized EBS application environments, and that's a pretty big limitation. Many, if not most, of our customers have enhanced their EBS environment in one way or another. Naturally, our customers want their EBS enhancements to be reflected on a mobile application, and you just simply can't do that right now. Beyond that, with Oracle's platform, the mobile app would look and feel Oracle-centric, whereas our customers generally want the ability to customize the mobile application with their company logo, color scheme, branding, etc. The second limitation we've come across is Oracle's mobile platform is iOS-centric as of today. It only works on one mobile OS. And we look out in the marketplace, Android has over 80% of the worldwide market share as of 2014, compared with just 15% for Apple's iOS. So, you know, thinking about the group we have with us today, the audience today, if we want to put that into perspective, we could look at it this way. Out of the more than 100 people attending this webinar right now, the standard Oracle mobile platform would work for about 15 of you. The rest would need a different solution. So limiting yourself to a single OS is generally not a viable solution for most businesses, especially with the prevalence of bring-your-own-device or choose-your-own-device policies that are common across organizations today. You'll see this in the demo coming up. OSI's Oracle Edge apps run on any operating system from any app store or from a private app store within your own network. Lastly, the Oracle mobile platform requires that you be running EDS release 1204 or higher, plus be running components of the Oracle SOA suite. So if you don't already own the SOA suite, there could be a licensing impact there if you have to buy it. Perhaps you already own it but haven't implemented it, which would lead to another project in order to, that you have to plan out and implement as a prerequisite to utilizing the standard mobile platform. So depending on your environment, the mobile platform may also require more processing power. And depending on your licensing with Oracle, there could be an impact there. OSI's solution works on any version of EBS and without a requirement of the SOA suite as a prerequisite. So that said, I'm sure you all want to see it, and I'm going to hand things over to my colleague Manoj right now. He's going to walk us through our solution, how it works, and show you a demo. So Manoj, please take it from there. Thank you. get some audio.
Okay. Yeah, I think there's just an audio connection. As there's just a disruption on Manoj's audio connection, just hold on 1 minute.
Okay, so thanks Glenn and thanks everyone for joining today. Our solution basically consists of our mobile application framework, which actually comes with a configuration console and application base. And later on, you can add modules as we go and add additional things like purchasing or accounting or requisition. They just keep on adding, basically. So what is this configuration console and application base that actually is different from everyone in the market today? So what we are giving the customers, our end users, is the ability for them to add the modules on the fly with zero impact to your employees. And at the same token, we are giving them the ability to disable fields or enable fields, the fields that you want to see or you don't want to see. You can actually do all the things with zero programming, no changes. The administrator can address those things on the fly. And the other advantage of going with the configuration aspect, the console, is the security features and everything is part of the configuration console, so the administrator can actually disable phones for your employees who are not employees anymore. You can block them, or you can actually, if someone complains about a lost device, we can go and delete everything on the device whenever it sees live on it. Okay, so with that thought process, so when we look at the overall aspect of it, right, where are we seeing this mobility opportunities, right? Today, everyone says the number one opportunity is basically on build on top of the workflows. So today's world, everyone has to do some kind of a job, and their managers have to review it and approve it. So for that to happen, today's requirement is someone is on the desktop or on their laptop approving it. So the moment you extend that feature to the mobile device, the statistics are saying people are going to save almost 600 million hours a year across, and then almost a $15.5 billion savings per year. So that's the key feature everyone is actually today working on. So what we did is we kind of started with this thing, and then we extended based on our framework, wherein actually we can address more than just the workflow aspect of it. So, but we'll start with this as a starting point. So as companies are looking at embarking on the journey, the things that they're going to need to worry about, right? The three main things that come into play are the cost. What is the cost? I mean, how much is it going to cost us for us to even start this journey? And then once we address the costing aspect of it, what are the things that I need to worry about? How complex is it? What are the various components I need to worry about it? And the last but not the least one is the data security aspect of it. Now we are exposing the data on these mobile devices outside our network. So what's the impact for us? So these are all the challenges any company has to go through, and that's where we actually come and help you guys to implement this and help you actually mitigate some of these issues for you. And companies also are now moving from BYOD to CYOD, where we are talking about choose your own devices. The companies also have to deal with these multiple complexities that come into play, whether we're talking about Android or iOS, but at the same token, within the Android itself, you're looking at Android releasing every version every 6 months. I mean, how do we address all these challenges? So those are the things as companies embark onto it. So one of the slides, this slide, I really want to talk about the security, what we really bring to the table, and actually give you some peace in the thought process about your data aspect of it is, within our framework, as we deploy additional modules, they all sit inside the heart of the box where you see the OTL, POR. These are all the modules that we develop, and that's pretty much is encompassed within the data encryption layer. So anything that goes outside the box is encrypted. So you should be not worried about your data, someone is looking into it. Then we actually added something called two-factor authentication, where however people access your systems, there's a two-factor authentication that happens. They need to log in with the username password, and the admin console guy is saying, okay, this is a valid phone for this employee, so we let it come in. Then the last one is the major thing. We actually work with your infrastructure piece. If you have a mobile device management or enterprise mobile management where you guys bought a product which actually manage this whole infrastructure, we actually work with you guys to make sure this is in accordance with that thing. Or if you guys don't have anything, we can even come up with our own app store that helps you install the whole thing. So when we talked about the physical mobile security, I mean, if anytime one of your employees loses their device, you should not be worried about the data being on the device and what if the data is sensitive. We actually have the ability to wipe out the device completely. So we do that from the app scope of it. So we just turn the flag on, and whenever the phone comes online, we go and delete everything. From the other aspect of the security, when you look at it, we actually have the standards basically where we audit and log who's doing what, and then the data validation, just make sure that there's no wrong data coming in, along with inactivity timeout. If someone logs in and he has been inactive for a while, we log him out forcefully. So that kind of addresses most of the feature, security risks that any organization is worried about. Then we'll more than welcome, we'll actually work with you guys to see if there's any other concerns you have that doesn't meet this framework. So how does this whole thing come into play, and how does this whole thing work, right? So if you look at the bottom of the green color box, letter A, that's pretty much your Oracle business instance. What we do is, based on your requirements, we actually look at if there's anything that Oracle has delivered as a standard PLC call package that we can actually expose it as a web service. I mean, even though we call it PLC call packages, even Oracle has some standard web services, we actually sit on top of it. So the other thing is, if you have an additional requirement or you have customized Oracle business suite, we actually extend our own thing with our own SQL packages, and then we expose it through the C aspect of it, which is your web service. That actually makes the connection with your mobile device. And if you look at the D, that's where your app configuration management console is, wherein you actually enable this new module to go live. And you can actually look at OSI has delivered these things with 10 fields, but we want only 3 fields to be entered by the employee. The console administrator can go disable those additional 7 fields. That kind of gives you the flexibility aspect of it. Okay. So with that thought process, I mean, you guys all know OSI has been in this business with supporting, implementing, upgrading Oracle applications. So with all that experience in line, so we started building apps that really helps the customer from the mobilization aspect of it. So we actually built quite a few apps like time and labor, cycle count, purchase order, requisitions. I mean, I just want to give you one aspect of it when you look at it. When you look at purchase order requisition, Oracle also has a standard thing for approving or rejecting it, right? We actually took it to one next level within the requisition aspect of it, where you can go create requisitions on the mobile device itself with the minimal data entry. And the other advantage is you should be able to scan documents on the fly and attach to the requisition. The same thing applies for the purchase order. And there's quite a few apps or modules that we are building that are in our pipeline. One of them is the customer 360 degrees. Well, the thing I want to talk about 360 degrees here is, if you look at it, every customer is interested in what is the end customer doing today, right? So when we go into this app, I should be able to see what is my customer's buying pattern for the last 6 months, whether you're talking about orders, or you want to look by items, or you want to even look at how many service requests he has raised, or if you're looking from a receivable perspective, what is my aging report for this customer? I mean, how much is past due? So if his field sales rep guy talking to the customer, he can see it in one shot, everything for him. So we actually are working on quite a few things. But at the same token, we will also work with you guys. If you have any other requirement, we'll work with you to build those modules for you. Okay? So now that we have these modules, customer has it, so how do I make sure my employees get these apps on their devices? So the standard way of getting is, if the employee has an Android device, they can go to the Google Play Store and download it, or if they have an Apple store, I'm an iOS Apple product, they can go to the Apple's App Store, or if they have Windows, they can go to the Windows Store and download it. But at the same token, if you look at it, right, as a bigger organization, they're looking at why are my apps on a public store? So we actually work with you guys where you have your private app store, or if you don't, we actually provide an app store wherein you can host your apps on it, and then you can have employees download it from the private app store. But at the same token, one of the advantages of going with the private app store is it's not just limited to these apps. I mean, any other mobile application that you are hosting today in your organization, you should be able to use those apps, I mean, app store to host them. So that's the advantage of going with the private app store. Okay? So now that you deployed it, why are you guys even interested in this product from OSI and not others, right? So what are the key salient features we bring to the table? We are pretty much platform agnostic. I mean, as Glenn mentioned today, Oracle is totally iOS centric, and on their roadmap they have Android. But for us, we actually build in one thing and we can actually deploy it on all these platforms, whether it's BlackBerry or Android or iPhone or Windows Mobile. So tomorrow some other new vendor comes in, we should be able to deploy it on that one too. So that's what we bring to the table for you guys. So your employees can be carrying any device. You're not restricted to only certain devices. At the same token, now the next question comes in is how scalable is it? We actually can support more than 1,500 to 2,000 employees on any concurrently. That's where we actually did our testing stress aspect of it. So it's pretty scalable. And we will work with you guys to look at if you have more than 2,000 concurrent users. I mean, we can actually take a look at it and see how do we extend it. Basically, we have this horizontally expandable thing, so we should be able to support even higher number. The other thing is the component-based architecture. What it really means for you guys or for everyone is, since remember the original console picture that I showed you guys, we are able to add modules on the fly. And your employees are not installing each module separately. So if someone, today you started with purchasing and later on you added time and labor, it automatically reflects on your mobile device. They're not installing it anymore. The admin console guy just adds this new module and boom, it shows up on all your employees' mobile devices. The last one, but not the least one, is extension by definitions. What we really mean by here is we come up with a standard traditional module that supports with zero customizations. We work with you guys for any changes or extensions that you want to extend your application, or you have done something within your Oracle Business Suite and you want to extend the same functionality in the mobile device, we can do that. It's pretty much pretty straightforward for us. The way our architecture and framework is built, we can extend the application the way we want and the way you guys want to look at it. So from the business perspective, the biggest challenge is time to market, right? So, I mean, traditionally people always used to talk about projects that span across 6 months, 1 year, 2 years. I mean, with mobile thing, that whole old notion has changed. We are talking about very swift implementations. You're talking about weeks, if not at the most 1 or 2 months. That's pretty much it for you guys to go live with one of these modules. And then what do we bring to the table is the highest quality. I mean, we are CMMI 3 certified. At the same token, the framework and all these things have been thoroughly tested and vetted out. So one of the things we guarantee is from the quality aspect of it, you can trust that it has been really tested all the way through from the application scope. Okay. So with that thought process, I want to just go through a quick run over the demo aspect of it, wherein you should be able to see within this application, someone actually installs the app. So if it has been hosted on their local app store, they actually go into it. I mean, this, whatever you see on the screen today is what you want to show on your app store. Then you see the devices that we support. They just download it. And then they go install it. And these install files are pretty small enough where it doesn't take a lot of bandwidth utilization and it goes out quickly. And once you trust it, there you go. If you look at the screen aspect of it, that's the skins. We actually work with you guys to change the skins that reflects your company's image. And the login username password is more tied to Oracle applications, the same username password. So you get the same responsibilities and within the same token. I mean, if he has been indented there, he won't be logging. He won't be able to log into this application anymore. And you see this, all those modules, those are the modules that you have looked at. And then if you, the person came into the console and disabled some of those modules, and you see those two modules disappear from the application. Now I'm just enabling the requisition module. And now when the employee goes and logs back in, you should be able to see the requisition module showing up on his application. That's how simple it is from the administration console. The other thing is, if you look at these various modules, I mean, we pretty much try to make it more very straightforward for people to search things, look at created, pending aspects of it, or you should be able to see various operating units and you can search for various purchase orders. So that's part of what we are trying to show you today right now. And then if you look at the fields that are in there, you see all the fields that it shows right now, the bill to is showing there V1 New York City, and the admin person came in and said, we don't need to display that field. He disabled that field on the admin console, and you see what happens is now if I log back in, and then if I go look at the same purchase order module, I won't be able to see the bill to module anymore, bill to field anymore. That's the flexibility we are giving all your organizations, saying, what do you want to display? So see, the build to is gone. That's the thought process from the console. That's the flexibility you're going to get. I mean, one of the thing is I expenses. I mean, we're just showing some of the applications, how they look and all the fields kind of a thing. And then within the requisition, as I was initially mentioning, we have both the features of creating requisitions and forwarding. That's why you have the view wherein you can see creating or pending. So within the scope of it, when you go through the menu, you see the requisition creation. That's where the creation screen is. So we'll work with you guys where in the requisition screen, if there's certain fields or segments that you guys have customized it, we can actually extend it to show up on your mobile device also. And all those validations, they're all tied back to your Oracle applications itself. So the data validation is done properly, so the person should not be able to enter something wrong data where it's gonna fail at the validation level. So now that the requisition is being created, we want to show you something from the Oracle application scope. I mean, he's just finding a purchase order and he's going to submit for approval. So once the purchase order has been submitted for approval, you will see that showing up on my mobile device instantaneously. That's the other thing you should be able to configure is how instantaneous you want. You want some time gap between. You should be able to configure those things in the console itself. I mean, that's the other thing you guys should be able to play with in the console. So the other aspect of creating a purchase order and is typically if you guys have installed some applications, you get the notification, there's a notification going on your mobile device. We actually support the same features. The moment it comes up on your mobile phone, you see the notification going in and you should be able to see the message even though if the phone is locked, you see as a similar to your text messages. So now that the employee has submitted for approval, now let me go back to the application. I'm going to query that purchase order. So here's the search screen that I was talking about. You should be able to search on anything. They just entered the purchase order number. It comes up and you see all the buttons at the bottom. They are pretty much coming from your workflow. If you have additional tokens, we pretty much show all the tokens that the workflow is supporting today from your application. And he's just forwarded to someone else, and that hierarchy is coming from Oracle applications itself. So now he actually forwarded this purchase order to Srinivas Gadapoli. So now let's go log back into the application using that username password on Oracle application and see how it's going to look for it. So now it's forwarding it. So he's going to log out and logging back as the Srinivas Gadapoli user Oracle's username password. Once he logs in, he should be able to see the same purchase order 6067 that's waiting for his approval. Now let's go query on it. 6067. There you go. It's sitting on him, on his thing, and now he clicks on the approve. So once the approve is done, pretty much the Oracle application instantaneously sees that message. It has been approved. So the workflow will push it to the next stage, whatever is a part of your workflow lifecycle. So we're going to just query that 6067 on the Oracle applications. And you should be able to see it now, the approval status has been changed to approved. Okay, so that's a quick demo, but if you guys are interested in any other module where you want to go in detail, we should be able to have a demo with our salespeople to go through it. And let me talk about the timelines and cost aspect of it. So typically what we have been doing is we come and sit with you guys and look at your requirements. And as I was talking about, we actually look at your Oracle applications and see if your requirements are able to be met by the standard Oracle PLC code packages or web services that have been exposed. We use those. If there's nothing like that, we actually build this. So to add to this thing, that's the key point here is, even though we are talking about Oracle's Edge apps on the e-business suite, we are actually can extend this to any other thing. So if you guys have data of truth sitting in multiple applications, whether it's e-business suite and some of them is sitting on a different legacy system, we can actually talk to multiple applications and render within one application if you want to do that kind of validation. So we can actually extend it to SAP or PeopleSoft, any of those apps. And then the next component is the visual design screens. We actually come up with various skins for your application modules, and then we want to vet it out with you to make sure it actually meets your company's look and feel. So once it's all signed off saying, yeah, this looks fine with our look and feel and everything, we build it and give it to you, wherein you can integrate and test the application, make sure nothing is, everything is working as per your requirements. Once it's all signed off, you push it to UAT, and based on your typical UAT lifecycle, you test it out, make sure everything is good, and then you go deploy it. With that thought process, I'm going to hand over to Glenn, wherein he will actually talk about the costs and timelines in detail.
Yeah, thank you very much for going through that, Manoj. Yeah, we're generally asked, okay, how long does it take to implement something like this. So to set up and implement the overall platform that Manoj was describing, plus the first mobile app, we're looking at about a 2 to 3 week time period. That gives you the platform, which has the pre-built security, the encryption, the admin console, along with the first app. And the pricing on that is $25,000. And then there's an annual support fee of $3,500 that covers enhancements, patches, etc. Additional apps that can be added to the platform can be implemented for $12,000 each. So we're going to get to the Q&A session here in just a minute, but I'll before we do that, I will just share briefly some information about OSI. We are a global Oracle Platinum partner. We've got 1,100 professionals across our offices in North America, Asia, and the Middle East. Our service offering spans the Oracle Applications and Technology portfolio, including Oracle's enterprise applications, development frameworks, middleware, and infrastructure. So now we will move on to our Q&A session. As a reminder, You can submit questions using the chat feature in WebEx on the right portion of the screen. We're going to take a few questions, answer as many as we can here in the next few minutes, and then we'll wrap things up. Okay, I got a few questions here. It looks like the first one is coming from Brian. What is included in the two-week implementation of the pricing you presented? So that set in that first 2 to 3 week period, you get the OSI Oracle Edge platform framework, which shows all of the control consoles that Noj was explaining for administration, security, et cetera, and the first application that you select, any one of those modules that we discussed. Okay, another question here from Jonathan. Will the Mobile Edge app work with other platforms that are not ERP? The answer to that is yes. The OSI's Edge platform is not limited to Oracle applications. That framework can be used for managing any mobile applications that your organization will choose to use. Those could be something that sits on top of EBS, like we talked about today, or it could be something that sits on top of multiple applications, perhaps a supporting a business process that spans Salesforce and Oracle, for example, or it could be for managing an application that has nothing to do with Oracle ERP. All right, we have a few more questions coming in from Deep. What happens if my employee loses their phone? So Manoj briefly touched on this when he was going through the console and the framework. You are able to shut down a device, the administrator can. So if somebody loses their phone, you don't have to worry about security breach or anything like that. You can control that centrally. Okay, Gary is sending a question. What if we have external users such as customers or vendors, et cetera? That's a great question. So for any of you who use some of Oracle's modules such as iSupplier, anything like that where you are able to set up an outside user, those same credentials can be used through a mobile app using the OSI framework. And so whatever you allow them to do via those modules, you can allow them to do via the OSI Edge app. I think we have time for one more question. Steve is asking, will the mobile app work on a jailbroken device? The short answer is yes. Manoj, do you want to extrapolate on that at all?
I mean, it pretty much works on a jailbroken device. Basically, the Apple's App Store actually controls those things. Basically, since we are deploying it through a private App Store, plus we are not looking at collecting the revenue from the Apple aspect of it. Those are the things where the jailbroken devices fail to work. For us, it should be fine.
Thank you. Okay. A couple more questions. Does the overall architecture of your solution assume that users are always online, i.e. have a cell signal? And that's related to another question that just came in, so I'll read both of them. It may be a continuation of the same question. Is there an offline mode? So, Manoj, I can take part of that. You might want to add some further context, but specifically for our cycle counting application, we have built in an offline mode because in many warehouses, there is little or no connectivity available. And so for that module, the answer is yes. And that same approach can be used for providing some offline mode access, I should say, in other modules. Manoj, do you want to add any other answers?
Sure. I mean, I just want to extend what you said, Glenn. Basically, we have built offline capabilities for the CycleCom, as what Glenn mentioned, but at the same token, we'll work with you guys if some of the modules that you want to take it offline where someone has to do some things where he has zero signal, we will able to work with you guys to identify those things and implement it. But at the same token, one of the other aspects of the question was how frequently or are they always connected it. So typically on the admin console, that's where we have the configuration wherein how you're pushing the data to the mobile device, how often it happens. So that's pretty much drives how frequently someone is getting an update from that scope. But at the same token, if someone created a purchase order and we just ping only that mobile device to get the notification, not to everyone. So they should be fine. It pretty much works similar to all the other notification engines.
Great. Thank you, Manoj. Manoj, we have a few more that I think will be good for you. The next question is, how is security being managed?
I mean, the security aspect of it, as I was talking initially, it's encompassed in multiple layers. We actually encrypt the data, and then we actually have the two-factor authentication where it's tied to your Oracle application's login, plus the admin console authenticates the IMEI number, so only that phone can come into our system. And then we actually, on top of it, we do the, it sits on the MDM and EMMM, so basically the security aspect of it is addressed thoroughly.
Okay, thank you. The next one for you, Manoj, how are the apps available? How are the apps available of the packaged version VBS, or can they work even if my version is completely customized? So the question is, can we use these apps on a customized implementation of VBS, and how much longer, if at all, would it take to adapt the apps to my custom platform?
Today, if you look at it, when we said 2 to 3 weeks, as Glenn mentioned, it's pretty much for a straightforward implementation of any module on your environment. Then when we talk about customization, how much of extensions you guys have done and how much you want to expose it on the mobile device, those requirements will actually derive how long it's going to take. But all I can tell you guys is the timelines are very aggressive for a mobile application, so you're still talking about weeks.
Okay. Okay, Manoj, do the apps support other forms of data entry such as barcode scans? I know the short answer is yes, but you could elaborate on that.
Yeah, we do support the scanning aspect of it. When we looked at when we implemented the cycle count application, when the person is literally in the warehouse, he's actually scanning the bin barcodes. That automatically gives you the inventory and information. So we actually do support scanning aspect of it. So based on the module and what we are implementing, we have the ability to scan barcodes.
Okay, thank you. All right, I think we have time for one more question, and that is, does your solution integrate with my single sign-on framework? Manoj, for you.
Sure. Today, the way we have implemented is we are using Oracle's username password as the basic authentication aspect of it. If you guys have implemented single sign-on where Oracle username password is the same, then we should be able to use the same thing to get you in.
Great. Thanks, Manoj. There are other questions coming in. That we don't have time to answer today. So what we're going to do is any question that went unanswered live on the webinar, we will follow up with you individually offline and get you that information that you're looking for. So I want to thank you all for joining us today. Certainly if you'd like further information on our Oracle Edge Apps solution, and how we think it could benefit your business, you can contact us at osidirect@osius.com. That email address you will see right there on that last slide. And then one of our colleagues will follow up with you, in addition to anybody who had submitted a question that went unanswered up to this point. We will get back to you on those as well. So thank you again for joining us today. We hope this was helpful and useful information for all of you. Have a great day, everybody.
Thanks, everyone.